What's up, everybody? Good to see you. Doesn't that make you want to go for like a hike? Some people are like, no, I want to go eat a bag of chips. But you might be wondering too, like how they got those shots like over the thing. And Michael has one of the spiritual gifts of levitation, which is really cool. Just kind of hovering over. That's how I imagined it anyways. Man, so good to see you guys. If you're new, I just really want to tell you this series that we're in, we're just starting this week, is it's called The Journey, and it really is the idea that life is a journey, that we're all on a spiritual journey. It doesn't matter so much where you've been or where you're at, but it's where you're headed that matters. And so we're going to be going into the bigger questions that people may have that are the obstacles that are keeping them from stepping into faith, or the obstacles that are keeping them from stepping into the type of faith that they know God is calling them to. It's moving us out of stagnancy and into real movement. And so I wanted to, before we jump into the talk today, I just wanted to celebrate a few things that I'm just so thrilled about. And I want to share them with you so we can celebrate this together. But last week we had Easter egg hunts all throughout the community. We had two in Ording. We had one in South Hill, Fredrickson area. We had one downtown, Puyallup, and we had one over in Bonnie Lake, and with the combined Easter egg hunts, they're really a gift to the community, no strings attached. We just want to bless people, make an environment of grace and belonging, and so kids and families can have fun and know God's love. We impacted over 700 people, you guys. That deserves a hand. I'm so thankful. Thank you, guys. Thank you for praying for it and being a part of that. The other thing is last week was Easter, and Easter was crazy, crazy fun. We had more people on campus than we've ever had before. We had almost 500 people coming to hear the good news about Jesus. That deserves a hand. Thank you guys for bringing friends. Thank you. That means that we're creating a well. For us, that means we're creating a place where people are being drawn to because they want to be here, and it's because of your love, because you're creating a place where people can belong even before they believe what you or I believe. And a few other things to celebrate, some minor things. One was 50 decisions to say yes to Jesus last week. Yeah, so awesome. And that's those decisions. Some of them were like, I'm making a decision to recommit. Some of them were for the very first time, which moves me to my next celebration is we had seven baptisms. People said, I want to publicly display my faith for my community and for anyone who would want to know that I am with Jesus, I'm on his team. And we had one at the end of the service, the second service, we had a guy at the very end of the service decide to get baptized, and he ran up and said, hey, do you have any time? And I remember asking all of you, I was like, hey, do we have time for one more baptism? And everybody said, amen, yeah, we can do that. So we baptized him, and he made that decision that day and got baptized that day to follow Jesus. So, so powerful, guys. God is on the move, and I'm so grateful. So would you just pray with me and just thank the Lord for what he's doing in our lives, that he's drawing us together. Even if I know there's hard things, real life is happening, but in the midst of it, God is moving, and he's changing us, and he's using those things. So let's thank him together. Father, we love you, and we just want to thank you that you are turning our hearts to you, that you are giving us a bigger vision of who you are, a bigger vision for our lives. Lord, would we be willing to continue to take risk? Lord, maybe the risk was just coming here today. Maybe the risk was just deciding to ask deeper questions. Maybe the risk was having a conversation with someone. Lord, would you help us to move forward with you? Today, would you speak to us from your word? Would you open our hearts so that we can hear from you? We pray all these things in your name. Amen. So last week, we took time at Easter to tell a story about a eunuch. How many of you guys were here for that? Kind of an interesting story to have some Easter, an Easter subject on. So it was kind of interesting. I was writing that sermon, and there was a point where I was like writing, so in essence, we're all spiritual eunuchs. And I was like, I don't know, that kind of sounds weird. And it's funny because today we're actually having a resurrection story. Normally you'd have the story of Jesus' resurrection on Easter, but just the way God was leading us, we did that story last week and people responded to the change that God brings. But today we're actually talking about the resurrection. But the cool thing is that if you are a believer in Jesus, or if you're at all drawn toward him and you're curious about him, you need to know that the resurrection is what it's about. A lot of times Christians and faith communities can start making faith more about the cross or about activities, doing good things in the neighborhood, in the world, which are wonderful. We need to have those. But the reason we do that, the big why behind all of that, even the cross, is the resurrection. Anybody can die. In fact, many religious leaders and political leaders have died for what they believed in. Jesus is just the first one to come back from the dead. And that's not a small thing. And sometimes Christians want to hide from that. They kind of want to put it in a back room and be like, we can talk about that later. You know, when you're at, no, like the resurrection is what gives us hope. It means that death and sin and heartache and all the things that pull us down and drag us down, all the darkness in the world was defeated because God said, none of that has the final word. I have the final word. My power is powerful enough to recreate and to give new life. And so the Christian hope is in the resurrection, which means that we're resurrection people, which means that we're Easter people every day. Are you guys with me? You see the importance here. We don't want to hide from that. We want to celebrate that. This is the hope for the Christian. And today, we're looking at a resurrection story. It's found in the book of John. If you have your Bible, you can turn there. We're going to have the verses on the screen behind me. It's in John chapter 20. We're going to be picking up in verse 24. And this story is so fascinating. This is a story where their leader, Jesus, has been crucified. And everyone that was in his movement, all of his followers are dejected. The dream has been destroyed. There is no hope. Their hopes have been dashed. And so they're in this state of despondency, the state of sorrow and heartache. And then some people have witnessed that he's returned. Some of his disciples see him return, and they start telling the other disciples. They start telling him, hey, Jesus is back. He's come. In fact, there's one gal named Mary who encounters Jesus. She doesn't even recognize him at first, and then she thinks he's the gardener taking care of the area of like burial, like gardener for all the tombs, and then she recognizes that it's Jesus, and they start going and telling other people, and we pick that up, and there's a guy named Thomas who wasn't a part of the crew who saw Jesus, and he's dejected and in sorrow. It says in verse 24, one of the 12 disciples, Thomas, nicknamed the twin. I love it. Jesus nicknamed people, and I think he will continue to nickname people as we, whether we're, you know, Christians now, I think God has nicknames for us, and I think when we're in heaven, he'll have nicknames for us. I know my name will probably be He Loved Movies, and that will be mine, and I know what my wife's is. It is Do Not Disturb When Sleeping. That will be her nickname, and probably is, and don't do it. So Thomas was not with the others when Jesus came, and they told him, we have seen the Lord. We've seen him. Check out Thomas's response. He replies, I won't believe unless I see the nail wounds in his hands and put my fingers into them and place my hand into the wound in his side. He's saying, are you kidding me? Like, there's no way. You guys are delusional. Like, I know he died. He was put on a cross. Nails were driven into his hands. There was a spear that was driven into his side to make sure he was dead. He was put in a tomb. We all know it. We all saw it. He's dead. The dream is over. You're delusional. Have you ever had that moment where, like, life is not going so well for you? You know, you lost your house, and all of a sudden your relative comes up, and he's like, hey, I bought a new house, and because the market crashed, like, I got this great deal. In fact, it looks a lot like yours. You know, it's like, oh, okay, thanks for that information, but I'm not ready to receive it. Or, you know, someone comes up, I got a new car, and you're like, oh, my car just stopped working. And you're, like, super bummed out in sorrow, and these other people are, like, having this great new realization, a great epiphany. And these ones come up, the disciples that he's a part of come up and they say, we've seen the Lord. He's like, no, you haven't. No, you haven't. He's dead. His vision for what God had done did not include a resurrection. It did not include Jesus coming back from something that no one comes back from. So he's in a place of despondency. And if I'm honest, like, I'm usually the skeptic. I'm usually the doubting Thomas. I'm usually the one that looks at a given situation. I look for what's wrong. I look for why it won't work. I'm the one who says, show me. Prove it to me. And like I've had to change and grow And God has done a work in my life so that I'm not always that way anymore. But for a time in my faith journey, I was the critic. I was the skeptic. I was the doubting Thomas. How many of you are the doubting Thomases in the room? You're like, show me. Okay, one of us. Okay, cool. Like, there's just a few of us, man. We got to stick together. I doubt their ability to doubt. How many of you guys are like, you guys are more positive. You see the good side of things. You're the believer. All right, I appreciate you so much. I didn't appreciate you so much when I was younger. I used to think you were foolish. I used to think like, you will believe anything. You will fall prey to anything. And some of us have become doubters like Thomas, whether we're people of faith or people that don't consider ourselves believers in Jesus or believers in God. I used to think I was so smart and superior at times because look at those people. They believe so easy. It's so easy to believe, I used to think, until God revealed to me that not only can anyone believe, but anyone can doubt too. Doesn't make you any smarter because you can ask the question why all the time. Why? Why this? Why that? Like, that won't work. Show me. It doesn't take any more brains to ask that. It needs to be asked at times. We shouldn't just jump on board with anything. And the Bible teaches us to have discernment, to understand whether something is truly good or something is truly bad or something's in between. Wisdom's really good and there's a place for it. But friends, when we just play the doubting Thomas role, when we play that all the time, like, we miss out on the best of life, don't we? Like, I never would have gotten married if I was just in the doubting Thomas mode the whole time. I remember there was a point where I had to say, like, okay, let's get married and actually propose and say, let's go for this. And there was a moment where I had to grab that woman's hand, Sarah, who's my wife, and I had to grab her hand and take her down the aisle. And that took faith because, like, up until that point, the whole dance of the dating and engagement thing was like, do you love me as much as I love you? And will you be there for me? Will you abandon me? Will you always be there for me? And those are the questions, like, that go through our minds. And I'm sure my wife had other questions, like, is there someone better? You know, like, am I settling? You know? So I'm not going to tell you what the answer to that question is. But we have those. That's right. It's totally not true. She didn't settle for anything. But if I remained in my doubt, I couldn't have moved forward with her. If she had remained in her doubt, she couldn't have moved forward. There's a place for doubt at times, but if it controls our vision of the future, we will miss out on the best of life. I would not know the life I have now. I would not know love. I would not know Sarah. I would not know my daughter, Novella, had I not been able to take a step of faith and say, look, I can't know with complete certainty that she will always be there for me, that she won't abandon me, that something tragic can happen to her or something in our future together. I can't with all certainty say, beyond any doubt, that this is going to be the way I want it to be. But if I remained in that place of doubt, I would never experience what I have today. Are you guys with me? We have to move beyond our doubts. And many of us, sometimes we doubt other people's beliefs without ever doubting our doubts. Thomas is, his vision of what God can really do in his life and the vision of God's power, the vision of what Jesus was about has all ended because of death. And he says, death has had the final word, like everything's over. And it's so fascinating to me that we can think, oh, well, I won't believe unless they show me. I won't believe unless I experience. I won't believe unless da 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 da. I won't believe any of these things unless it's revealed to me. And I think it's so fascinating because we have to experience it, we have to see it, we have to see all these things, but we don't ever doubt our doubts. We doubt other people's beliefs. We doubt what they say. I've seen Jesus. Yeah, sure. I remember being a kid in church and people saying, I found the Lord and he said this to me. I'd doubt him right off the bat and be like, okay, they're one of those people. I never doubted my doubts. If we never doubt our doubts, then we're never really able to move past them sometimes. You guys with me on this? Like the doubt about God, or is God really fully going to be there for me? Well, where does that doubt come from? Maybe it comes from the fact that you've had people who haven't been there in your life, who haven't stuck with it, who have abandoned you. And so you're letting that experience inform your experience about God. Maybe, you know, your anger towards God, or maybe your anger toward a church is because of this thing that happened back there, but you don't doubt that. You don't doubt that maybe there was something wrong with that experience that doesn't actually inform you about God or doesn't inform you about church. But because we get so focused on doubting other people's beliefs and doubting the good, that we're not able to doubt the bad. You see, that's crazy. It's a crazy pattern that we have. Whether we've been hurt or disappointed, God didn't give us the life we wanted, not the job we wanted, like this relationship, this thing I wanted. God maybe allowed your heart to be broken in a situation, but we've lost the bet too many times on God. We've lost the bet too many times on faith, on my journey, on these people, on this community. And I'm so tired of losing the bet that I'm just gonna cash it in. I'm gonna walk out. How many of you guys have ever experienced that, where you're ready to walk out on God, ready to walk out on church, ready to walk out on this thing? Friends, we're all on a journey. Some people are at a point where they're like fully, like, you don't even know why you're here. You've been so resistant to anything. You have so many doubts. But for some reason, you're starting to move to a point where they're turning from just doubts to questions where you want to move forward. You're becoming more curious about God. And some of you are at a point where you've been curious and you've asked your questions, you've been experiencing God. And you're at a point where you're ready. You're ready to, you want to talk with someone and say, okay, how can I put my faith? What does that look like? Can you show me? And some of you have received him. You're at a point where you're like, I just did that. Like last week, George, like I'm ready to move forward. I received him and now I'm ready to move to the next step. And the next step for you may be moving into a place where you're experiencing community and new life. You get to experience all the things that God has for you, and you want that and you want to move. And then maybe you've experienced community. You've been doing that for a long time and you're like checked out. And maybe there's been a moment where you've been with church, or maybe there's just a life thing that's happened. You've had a loss, or you've had a new addition to the family, and you're like crazy busy, and there's so much, and you're just happy with where you've kind of gotten complacent. And there's a part of you that said, okay, God, at one point in my life, I gave my life over to you, but it was really kind of like a 50%, or it was a 75%, or, you know, like George had a really good sermon a few weeks ago, it bumped it up to 77%. But you're holding back a percentage. And for you, it might be saying, okay, God, I'm going to give all of me. I'm going to fully devote my life to you. Like, all the things that I've given you, I've got this group over here, this stuff over here, I've never fully said it's yours, and it's your turn to say this is yours. Maybe your next step is learning to be a disciple maker, where you go from having everyone pour into you, where you pour into others, and you start making disciples. We're all on a journey. Where are you at? What are the barriers? What are the doubts? What are the problems? And where do you want to be? How are you going to get there? How are you going to get through those issues? How are you going to get through those problems? But Thomas in this story is having those issues, and often he's the hero, that place of doubt. And I want to tell you, when you're in the place of doubt and you want to cash out, and this is what everybody, like, this is what our culture says, well, you're smart if you doubt everything. I want to tell you, there's a different story to be written. Let's continue with this story. It says in verse 26, 8 days later, the disciples were together again. And this time, Thomas was with them. This time, it was different. The doors were locked, but suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them. Peace be with you, he said. That's a pretty cool entrance, right? Jesus is a pretty cool guy. Imagine if he just like appears here. That'd be pretty crazy. I think we'd have a lot of conversions if we did that today. He'd stand there and he'd be like, peace be with you. That's pretty cool. That's what he says to these guys. And then he says to Thomas specifically, he says, hey, I know what you said. Word's gotten back to me. Put your finger here and look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't be faithless any longer, but believe. Don't disbelieve, but believe. Quit believing your doubts more than the things you need to believe. Quit remaining in the shadow lands and step out into the good life, into the best of life. Step into the truth. Step into who I am. Step into a bigger vision for your life. Would you imagine Thomas and Jesus is looking at you and you've got all your doubts, and Jesus is saying, hey, put your hand into the holes in my hand, put them into the side. Do you think Thomas actually did? Do you think he actually was like, well, let me go figure out if this really is you, Jesus? No. I mean, that's what the cross and resurrection does for all of us, doesn't it? It stares back at our face, and it's God saying, hey, I called that pocket, and then I sunk the billiard ball in that pocket. I called it death and resurrection, and I saw my son die for the sins of the world, for your sins, and then I raised him back to life. Now it's your response. Ball's in your court. What are you going to do? That's what God does with us, with our doubts. He says, look at this, what I did. Look at the fact that you can breathe, the fact that you have a life, the fact that I'm so gracious that I've given you the will to choose how to live and what to believe. What are you going to do? And that's the moment that Thomas is in. I think it's unbelievable. And there's this thing we have to learn about this passage that I just think is so powerful. In this passage, it says, 8 days later, the disciples were together again. There's a really important thing about eight. The way we will discover this is jump down to verse 30. The disciples saw Jesus do many other miraculous signs in addition to the ones recorded in this book, the book of John. But these miraculous signs are written so that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, you will have life by the power of his name. He wants you to believe so you'll be saved. And to believe, we want to bear witness. We want to be like the disciples that said, we saw him. We want to tell you about all the things he did. We want to tell you all this amazing stuff about Jesus so you'll know the resurrection power. And the reason that I wrote this book is so that you'd know. And I wrote about these signs, these miraculous things. Okay, so you're like, if you read this at the end of John, you got to reread it. So John writes this book so that you have to read it and then reread it. Tricky little teacher, right? Like, you're like, I had a teacher like that and they would trick me and I hated him. Well, John does that. And if you were to reread this book, you'd realize, like, after a miracle that Jesus does, there's this first miracle. It says this was his first miraculous sign. Then another one happens and it says, and this was his second miraculous sign. And then as you go through the book, you start counting them because you're supposed to count like this witness of what Jesus is and what he did. And you count a third one, a fourth one, it gets all the way up to seven. There's seven miraculous signs. And guys, this is really powerful because in the Bible, if you didn't know, seven is like the mysterious number of God. Whenever you see the number seven, it somehow points to God. And it's something powerful is going on. We're supposed to take note. We're supposed to stop in our tracks and say, okay, God, what are you doing? Because something powerful is happening. It harkens back to the Genesis story where God created the whole world. And on the first day, he started creating. He saw that it was good. And the second day, he started creating more and saw that it was good. And then it goes on and on until what day? The seventh. And he rested and said, all this is good. Seven. 7 days, and all of creation. What did God make in those 7 days? The Garden of Eden. Perfection. The way he wanted things to be. Between humans and the world and the earth and with him. Everything as it should be. The Garden of Eden. And it's this amazing story. And there's these seven miraculous signs until John throws us off. And Jesus is raised back from death. He's raised back to life. Would you consider that a miraculous sign? Yes. So how many miraculous signs are there actually? There's eight. It's interesting. It says 8 days later, the disciples, something is going on. What is the eighth day? What does that mean? There weren't 8 days. There were 7 days in creation. What does eight mean? It's really important. Check this out. Remember Mary saw Jesus and who did she think he was? The gardener. It's John going, hey, the gardener is back. And the gardener is starting a new creation. And the eighth day is the new first day of recreating the world. And the way God recreates the world starts with turning doubters into believers. And the new creation is Jesus, his new body, his new life, resurrected fully, like heaven crashing into earth, brokenness receiving life and light. The gardener has returned. And the Creator is now recreating on the eighth day, the new start of creation. You guys with me? Is this not powerful? Does this open our eyes to a new vision? And look at Thomas's response. He says in verse 28, my Lord and my God, Thomas exclaimed. Then Jesus told him, you believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me. He says, my Lord and my God. He believes. He says, you believe, but you've seen me. He's like, there are going to be those who come after who have to witness me through other circumstances and through the witness and testimony of these books and the witness and testimony of other believers. And when they believe, and when they get a bigger vision for their life, I will change them and you won't even recognize them because I'm doing a recreation project in them. And blessed are those, all of us here, all those who made decisions last week, all who have ever decided to follow Christ. And I'm not like seeing Jesus in the flesh, but we've seen his work in the world. His Holy Spirit has changed us and wooed us and transformed us into people who are kingdom people, resurrection people. Blessed are we who believe. And I wanted to get to the heart of this. Thomas has a problem. His doubts are the problem. He's got all these barriers, and there are many here who have barriers that are keeping you from moving to the next step. You can't trust God. You can't believe in God because da-da-da-da-da. You can't give him the rest of yourself. You can't start making disciples because of this barrier, this fear, this thing. And I want to tell you that we aren't kept from belief in God. We're not kept from following God because of these obstacles, because of these barriers. I mean, they keep us a little bit, but the true barrier, the true problem, is that we don't have a big enough vision of God. These barriers do not keep us from believing in God. The true barrier is we have too small a vision of God. And your vision of God determines your vision for your life. And you know how I know many of you struggle with belief? You know how I know many of you struggle with doubts about God? Because you struggle with doubts about yourself. You struggle with taking risk. You struggle with having joy. You struggle with having thanksgiving. You have struggle with believing and having a big vision of the world around you. My daughter, one time we were walking her, and as we were walking her, we were right by my house, and she always notes everything before we do. She hears the train. She's like, train. She sees, you know, she hears when the mom comes home, and the garage door opens. She's like, Mama's home. Hears it before me every time. And she looked up and she said, Daboon, Daboon. It's the moon. It was so interesting. I looked up and it was getting towards dusk. And there was this big round balloon. It had a big, huge string with all these flags attached to it that went down to one of the car lots. Our home's not too far from some car lots. And you could see it go up, and it looked just like the moon. There were these lights shining on it. It was getting toward dusk. It was beautiful. It was so cute. The moon, the moon. And the really funny thing was the actual moon was like not too far over. It was right here, and it was just shining super brightly. But she thought the balloon was the moon. Interesting thing is that I think many of us have grown up with faith that way. We've grown up, many who have grown up in the church or with some kind of faith, at some point, the way someone lived, the way someone loved, the way someone described God to them was more of a balloon. And so they put their trust, or they started, the way they thought, and when they look at God, they were thinking about the balloon. And when the true God, the real moon, is over here. And at some point, you grow up. At some point, my daughter, she's going to grow up. And I didn't have the heart to say, no, novella, the moon's over there. Maybe I should have. I don't know. Maybe I should be more harsh in my critique of her. You two-year-old, you should know better. And it was, but it's cute. You know, she's 2 years old. That's da boon, da boon. She's getting it kind of right, and she's learning about it. And there's a place where we need to learn, okay, that's the shape of God. Okay, we're learning more about who God is, but we don't have it all figured out yet. But if she was like, say, 15 years old, and you were at my house, and all of a sudden my daughter pointed up, 15-year-old girl novella, and she says, Daboon, Daboon. And it's this dealership balloon. And you'd be like, that's a little weird. If she was 30, and she was talking to her friend, she's like, oh, I can't wait. She's coming home from college. Hopefully she goes to college. You got to come to my house because at my house is where the moon is. I've been all sorts of places and I can never find the moon. Only at my house is where the moon is. And you get to our house, she points to her friends and you're there and she says, Daboon, Daboon. You'd be like, okay, this is more than weird. This is just wrong. This isn't right. And what happens is we have to grow up, and we have to, if we keep our vision of God as a small, puny God, or the small balloon, the small thing that isn't quite as majestic or as big or as powerful as he really is, what we end up doing is because we're focused on the balloon, we don't see the moon. Because we're focused on our small vision of God or our small vision of what our life should be, we don't see God. And if you have a big vision of God, you have a big vision for your life. I want to challenge us, friends, to be able to move forward on our journey, to even want to move, to even have the ability to move past the obstacles. We have to have a big vision of God. Amen? And I'm not talking about some vision that someone else is giving. I'm talking about huge, crazy, awesome, forgiving, creative, all-powerful, all-knowing vision of the Lord who gave himself and his son Jesus to know and love us in a real relationship, like a vision that will transform you. I'm going to ask that if you have a vision for that, you will be able to move forward. And if you have a vision for that, I'm going to tell you right now that if you start the journey, if you start taking the next step, even if you're at like real, you're skeptical about God at all, and you start the journey, I guarantee you in a year, you won't recognize yourself. You won't recognize who you've become because Jesus is the great gardener. Jesus is going to change your life. He is going to recreate you in a way you never could have imagined. You're going to have more hope in your life, more joy in your life, more ability to suffer with people. Like life is hard, but you're going to have a hope that nothing can destroy because death can't destroy Jesus. Death can't destroy his power in your life. You don't have to be afraid of things anymore. I'm telling you, you will not recognize yourself if you have a big vision of God and then a big vision for you. I wanted to close with this story. This is a little different. There are four men. These four men decided to take a journey, and they traveled to a point where they had to make a decision. The reason these men decided to start their journey was because they had heard of this great land. This great land, greater than all other lands, but it was a distance, and they had to travel, they had to find it. And as they traveled, they came to this point of decision, and the point of decision happened because they all hit the beach. They arrived at this beach, and they're all different journeys to get there, but they got to this beach, and they realized that the land was beyond the sea, and so they had to travel there over sea. And when they got to the beach, there were two men, one over here, and there was one man over here. And they went to the first man, all four of them went to the first man because he was closest. And they asked him, how can we get to the great land we seek? And he said, well, you can buy a boat from me. And they were like, wow, that's amazing. How much is it? And when he told them the cost, it was a great price. But even more than the price, he also said, I have a list. And this list, you have to change your life. You have to change who you are before I will give you the boat. You have to change your appearance. You have to change things about yourself, and you have to give me the great price, and then I will give you one of my boats. Well, one of the men thought, well, I need to buy a boat, and I've got the money, and I can do these things. He looked at the list, even though it was very hard. He's like, I will attempt to do this to get the boat from you. The other three men thought, let's go talk to the other guy. So the other three went and talked to the other man. They went down the beach, and it was an old man, just white, silvery hair, wrinkled skin, sun-browned, really clear blue eyes, and they asked him, how can we get across to the great land? Can you help us? The man said, yes, I'm a boat builder. And they're like, really, you look very old. And how old are you? And he's like, I'm older than the sea. And one of them said, yes, I believe it. And they said, so how much does your boat cost? He says, my boat is free. My boat is free. You just have to take it and trust that it'll be good enough. When they saw the boat, it didn't look as fancy as the other boat. It didn't look as fancy as the others. And so they looked at it. It looked a little shabby. It didn't look quite as great. And so two of them, thinking I could build a better boat, moved on. But one of them said, well, I have no boat skills. I don't know how to make a boat of my own. So I will trust this man. The other two went on, and one of them said, you know, I'm an inventive man, I'm creative, and I'm very, very good at building new technologies. So I will build myself my own boat, and it will take me where I want to go. It will be the greatest boat ever built. And then the fourth man wasn't quite as good a builder on his own, wasn't quite as inventive, but he knew he could piece something together. And he looked on the shore, and there were all these old shipwrecked pieces of boats and ships. And so he said, what I will do is I will take all these pieces from all these other boats and all these other ships, and I will put them together into one ship, and I will make one boat, and I will travel the sea on many boats that are one. And over time, they all got ready, and they all got in the water, and they all set off. Happens. Okay, a few of us. You're going to have to continue the series. Come the next few weeks. I want you to be thinking about this. What do those characters represent? If you want to know, what do they represent? Where are they going to go? What's going to happen? Why does that happen to them? I think it's really, really important. We're all on a journey. And I want you to, if you have your connection card, would you take time today to fill it out and say, here's where I'm at in my journey. And here are my barriers. I don't know enough Bible. I'm not perfect enough. I have a bad past. I'm complacent. I'm this. I'm that. What are the barriers keeping you from moving forward? And would you turn that in? Because I want to make sure our series meets you right where you're at. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we love you. We thank you for how good you are to us. We ask that we would just worship you with everything we have. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to have a vision that's bigger than maybe what we've thought. Well, I pray that you would help us to quit just looking at the balloon and actually look at the moon, Lord. We would actually look at the true version of who you are, and Lord, that you would become so great to us that we would be able to change our lives. And we pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. You want to